When the full reopening of the economy was announced, this brought a ray of hope and brought optimism among business owners who were happy to make up for lost time. Just in time, like no one predicted, the fuel prices shot high, and now the bars of soap and cooking vegetables are also getting pricey. The blame is channeled toward what manufacturers call a 10% tax that was imposed on crude palm oil, a vital raw material in the manufacturing of these products. So who is the winner and who is the loser? Welcome to The Business Show. Now here are stories that made headlines in the business world this week. Monthly inflation rises 1% in February. G7 meets tourism stakeholders to iron out challenges. 70% Ugandan grains contaminated. Government to support domestic investors in the oil and gas sector. War in Ukraine threatens world economic recovery.
We derive our inspiration from our ancestors who used cow ghee to moisturize their skin.
The country. Google pays zero tax from ad revenues they make in Uganda. So does Facebook, zero tax. You know, YouTube, zero tax. And we're spending a lot of money to advertise on this platform.
Welcome to the show. Budding businesses in Uganda seem to keep getting shocks that are not favorable for growth. The latest being complaints about the Euro 8 tax that was suggested for online businesses after realizing that a lot of money was being lost in untaxed businesses online. Tonight on Views from the Top, Ron Kawamala, the CEO Jumia, weighs in on the effect of such a tax and says this should be rather imposed on giants like Amazon, Facebook, and YouTube.
My name is Ron Kawamada. I'm CEO of Jumia in Uganda. And we've seen a big uptake of e-commerce in the country. We've seen more and more Ugandans, more and more businesses go online, especially in the last 3 years. People have seen the value of automation, the value of technology, especially when it comes to staying home and staying safe. And so it's the best time for e-commerce, for the ecosystem, logistics, the internet, vendors. And so we hope that what we've seen, this trend is sticks, and so far it's sticking well. More to come. COVID did not bring online trade. Online has been there. Perhaps it accelerated some of the trends that were already in motion. There was already millions of people who are buying online in Uganda. There's a few more who came in who maybe would have never come. But COVID just accelerated the trends that we already had. Jumia and many other companies were here for the last 9-10 years and have been seeing remarkable growth year over year. And so COVID perhaps made it more easy and perhaps easy to try. But the trends were already here. We had already invested in our logistics ecosystem, invested in our technology, invested in people. And so when COVID came, we were ready to meet the demand, to support our customers, to support our vendors, and to support our partners. Well, I think online trading has massive advantages. Number one is the issue of price, right? Because the online companies don't have the overheads that other brick and mortar companies do have. They're able to get products from the manufacturer or the distributors directly into massive warehouses and distribute it to the customers. So this makes them cheaper. Then there's an issue of quality assurance, because we give customers the opportunity to return the products if they don't like them. They can return them for any use. They can receive them. You don't pay for them if you don't like them. So there's a lot of power and trust that's given to the customer to make sure that they're able to control what they buy. Prepayment or by paying online, we give massive opportunity. You can pay by mobile money, you can pay by Visa, MasterCard, you can pay cash on delivery. So there's massive opportunity to pay with many multiple options. This makes it easy. But the biggest one is that for those people who don't live in the major towns, major cities, don't live in Kampala, they don't have access to good retail. So if you're living in smaller towns and smaller areas, products are more expensive. Sometimes they're not even available. You have to travel to the big towns like Kampala to access these products. But through online business, you're able to get these products, whether you're in Luwero, you're in Kabale, in Fort Poto, in Guluo, in the deepest of the villages, you're still able to access these products. Jumia is able to deliver in every district, in every part of the country. So accessibility is made easy through online businesses. Well, I think online businesses come in all shades. There's the informal ones, young man who finished university, posts on Facebook, is selling shoes. Those are there, and we want them to do well and thrive. Someone who posts, he does hair, his saloon is, they come to your home, they're using the internet to do that. Those are great. Now, whether it makes sense for URA to focus on those young people who are just trying to sell things online, using Facebook and social media, that's up to them. But we know there's big players who don't pay taxes. You know, we know very well that Facebook, who makes millions of dollars every year in Uganda, YouTube makes millions of dollars every year, billions of shillings every year. Google makes billions of shillings every year in Uganda. They pay zero tax. They pay zero tax. So those are the people that we should be focused on. Those guys who pay zero tax from the revenues, the ad revenues they're making in the country. Google pays zero tax from ad revenues they make in Uganda. So does Facebook, zero tax. You know, YouTube, zero tax. And we're spending a lot of money to advertise on these platforms. So, but they're not paying any taxes in Uganda. Now, a company like Jumia and others, we pay massive taxes. You know, we're IFRS registered, all our vendors are paying taxes, we're paying taxes, we're remitting VAT, we're remitting PAYE. When we're profitable, we remit corporate tax. And so it's unfair because we have to pay all those taxes, you know, and many other companies have to pay those taxes. But the biggest players who are in online space, Google, Facebook, Amazon, pay zero tax in Uganda. So we can say, let's go after the guy who has finished university trying to sell shoes online, or somebody who's selling dresses online. Yes, but is that where the real value is? Is that where the money is? No, it's not. It's the big players. EU has come out, they tax them in Europe. So Facebook and Amazon and all these guys now, they're paying taxes when they go to Europe. They're not paying in many African countries because we don't have regulations about, you know, those companies who are offering us services in the country without having a physical presence. Google, Facebook, Amazon, YouTube are not incorporated locally, right? They're able to give remote services in the country and able to take out the cash, but without paying any tax. Now, other European countries, the European Union has ensured that everything that is consumed in Europe must be paid for through a sales tax or some sort of tax that these companies do have to pay. Well, the tax base in Uganda is very small, right? 80% of the economy is still an informal economy, which means they're not incorporated, they're not paying taxes, they typically sometimes don't even have a physical address. So that is not just an issue for the online small guys who are selling online without really having a structure, right? So we need as a country to do better, to support these guys. Now, you know, it's also very tricky to for these young companies, young students who are starting up something, whether it's offline or whether it's online, to get no support, to get no business support, to get no support when they're trying to operate the business, to get no support when they're getting loans, but you're quick, you want to tax them as soon as they make a sale, right? So we need to balance the two, right? If we need to tax them, we also need to give them some sort of support so they can actually incorporate the business, so they can actually get the physical address, so they can actually be able to replenish their stock, they can actually do some marketing. There's so much we can do. And once you get these guys some sort of support, whether it's a loan, whether it's some sort of financing, they come out of the shadows, right? But when you're benefiting nothing from government, benefiting nothing from any sort of program available, but they're looking to tax you, these guys will stay in the shadows. We want them to come out of the shadows, and because we want the tax base to grow. At the moment, very few companies, you know, Jumia is in the large taxpayer category in Uganda. So we pay a lot of taxes, but we don't want that. We want everybody to pay their fair share. So then the burden on those few who are paying is reduced. Cost of the internet is high and has been high for a long time. which means that it's more expensive for young people, for small companies to be able to go online, for businesses who want to trade online to go and do it. But what did we see more recently is that on top of that, we ended up increasing taxes on the internet. And so we're already taxing the internet aggressively, so it has made the internet even more expensive. And so if you want to grow your tax base on the internet, then tax where the value is added, right? Typically, the fundamental of growing, of taxing, you tax value, right? And so the value is not on the consuming of the internet. The value should be what happens once you use the internet to transact, to create jobs, to create products, to sell products. That's where the value is, and that's what should be taxed. But right now we've done it the reverse, which means that less people will be able to use the internet to be able to create value. And when there's less value created, it means there's less taxes to take for government. I think that it's tricky, of course, for the tax authorities. On the one hand, we need to raise money so we can continue to grow the country. But also we need the businesses to first fully recover before we increase the tax burden. And the reality is that we have to find a balance. We have to find, the law is the law, that if the tax law has been passed, you have to pay it. And the URA has actually been quite lenient in the last two or three years, whereby companies who struggled, companies who were not able to pay, are able to make special arrangements with the URA and work out payment plan. Voluntary disclosure for those who didn't pay the taxes, and they can waive the penalties and the interests. And so URA has been quite lenient and understanding of the businesses who have suffered during COVID. And many of them have suffered, have not made no money. Some of them have made very limited money. Overall, I felt they've taken the right approach. And I think that that's what we need going forward, is that to balance between, you know, the need to raise money with the need not to strangle the businesses, that we need to continue to employ our people and to create value in our economy. Well, e-commerce is a very difficult business with very many moving pieces, you know, from the supply chain to the order processing and management, to the delivery, to the technology, to the content, revenue collection. It's massive. And so you have to do this right. But the most important thing is quality, consistency of the service, right, and the after sales. And so a lot of people focus on one thing and not the other. They build a good technology, but they don't invest in quality assurance. They invest in good quality assurance, but they don't get the right vendors who have the right pricing. And there's many challenges along the way. Again, the supply chain disruption can mess up your pricing, right? The new tax regime in the country can mess up your pricing. The issues of logistics can mess up your pricing and your customer experience. And there's issues of internet availability, the internet costs can all affect your pricing, your access. So as a young entrepreneur, for those who want to get into online business, you have to be very comfortable solving all those issues by yourself. If you're not able to solve them, then you have trouble being able to scale the business. What Jumia has done is create an environment whereby we have the best vendors, we work with the biggest brands, we have penalties in place for those who don't give the right service and the right quality. We've built a robust logistics network across the country of pickup stations and door delivery. We have built massive investment in our technology and our tools. We've invested in people. We have hundreds and hundreds of staff. We have thousands of delivery agents. We have payment systems that allow Visa, MasterCard, American Express, mobile money, cash. All these things are extremely important to be able to give the customers the right products, the right service consistently.
Well, it's no doubt that raising revenue to be able to support the economy is very important, but this has to be done without destroying recovering businesses. Thank you very much for staying tuned to The Business Show. We are taking a short break and we shall be right back.